suggest the presence in the universe of a matter which is different from the baryonic matter that we know. For example, the anomaly in the galaxy rotation curve, which if we measure the velocity of the rotation of the galaxy as a function of the distance from its center, we obtain a curve which is very different from what we expect from the visible light, suggesting the presence of some matter which doesn't emit light. There are the evidences from gravitational lenses, where again the gravitational distortion of light rays is compatible with the presence of a mass which is much bigger than what we see. Additionally, the CMB temperature anisotropies shows peaks which can be attributed to the presence of a matter which is not baryonic matter. And this non-baryonic matter fits also in the Friedmann equation to explain the evolution of the universe and the actual abundances of matter that we observe. All of these evidence suggest this matter which interacts gravitationally, but it doesn't interact electromagnetically. So we call this matter dark matter. There are many candidates that have been proposed to explain dark matter, and this candidate, as you can see, spans many orders of cross-section and masses. But one of these candidates is a very well-testable and plausible hypothesis, which are the WIMPs here, which are compatible candidates with beyond the standard model extensions, such as supersymmetry. And additionally, supposing a cross-section of the order of the weak interaction, these candidates fit as a relic matter from the early universe. From the galaxy rotation curves, we expect WIMPs to be distributed in an halo which embed our galaxy, and with our rotation around the center of the galaxy, we should expect an apparent dark matter wind. And since we are moving toward the Cygnus direction, we should expect a wind of dark matter of one that moves against us at 242 kilometers per second. Okay, given let's say the masses of the WIMP and their velocity, we expect them to interact efficiently with atomic nuclei, producing very low energy nuclear recoil of order keV. Other than gravitationally, of which we are sure, we hope that this dark matter could interact also through weak interaction, and this would give an interaction rate of order one nuclear recoil per kilograms per year. And these events must be searched within 10 to the 5 or 10 to the 6 events per year, given from electron recoil from natural radioactivity, plus the flux of one muon per centimeter square per minute. So experiments to search for this dark matter signal have to operate in underground laboratories to suppress the muon flux. They have to expose very high masses and employ ultra-radio poor material. And they have to discriminate very well from electron recoil and nuclear recoil, especially at low energy, to be able to isolate this nuclear recoil signal. Another thing that experiment could do is to search for a directional signal. Indeed, as this wind WIMP is expected coming from the Cygnus constellation, since the Sun, in its rotation around the center of the galaxy, is moving towards the Cygnus constellation. By kinematic, a dark matter interaction will produce nuclear recoil all in the same direction, pointing in the opposite side of the Cygnus constellation, while instead the background shouldn't show any particular preferential direction. So a very clear dark matter signature would be an excess of events in galactic coordinate, backpointing towards the Cygnus constellation here over a background that is isotropic. Thus, a directional detector able to measure both energy and direction of the recoil would be sensitive to this unique feature, and no background whatsoever can mimic this feature of excess of nuclear recoil events from the Cygnus constellation. Okay, as a detector to search for this directional signature, we proposed a time projection chamber. Time projection chamber works like this. So a charged particles crosses the sensitive volume and ionizes the gas. Then the trail of electron is transported to the anode, maintaining its original shape. The electrons are amplified and read out. Given we work at atmospheric pressure, indeed, given the low density of the gas, a nuclear recoil is expected to travel order 1 millimeters before being absorbed. And with the latest advancement in micropattern gas detector and readout technology, we can reach performances of threshold lower than 1 kV and a submillimeter spatial resolution. Indeed, this is a 6 kV nuclear recoil that we have observed in Cygnus. So this is, of course, a trade-off. There is a huge trade-off between mass and exposure because our target is made of gas, but we have the advantage of the directionality and a very low threshold. Okay, in particular in Cygno, Cygno consists of a time projection chamber filled with a gas mixture of helium CF4 in proportion 60-40 at atmospheric pressure. The primary electrons which are transported to the readout are amplified by a triple gas electron multiplier system. And during the electron amplification, the electron break the CF4 molecules, and when they break the CF4 molecules, scintillation light is emitted. Then the photons are collected by a CMOS camera and photomultipliers. The CMOS camera gives us the 2D informations of the tracks with a very high granularity, while the PMT gives us the temporal information. And by combining these two approaches, we are able to perform 3D reconstructions of the tracks. Okay, the advantages of the CMOS is that we have a very high granularity. Indeed, for example, in LIME, on 33-centimeter pictures, we are able to image 151 micrometers per pixel. And this is thanks to the equipment of the lens. We have a very simple readout. Indeed, to read the CMOS camera, it's enough a simple USB cable. And with the new models of CMOS cameras, we are going towards the single photon counting. The camera shows also a very low noise, and additionally, this technology is pulled from the market. It's enough to think about the cameras of the TELAS generation telephones, which are continuously evolving. Combining this with the PMT, which is a very fast device, which provide the relative Z position and the integrated charge measurement. Additionally, since our sensor is placed very far from the sensitive volume of the detector, this induce also a very reduced, this imply a very reduced radioactivity. One drawback of this is the solid angle, which is a function which is 10 to the minus 4. And so we have to work with very high gains. Okay, at the moment, we started with phase zero with some R&D projects and prototypes. We are now here at the end of the phase zero, at the beginning of the phase one, when we are building the order one cubic meter demonstrator. And in the phase two, we are planning, if this will work, we are planning to build the 30 cubic meter experiment that will be used for physics research. So this is the latest prototype that we have developed, which is LIME, called the Long Imaging Module. This prototype shows a 50-centimeter drift length, a readout area of 33 times 33 centimeters square for 50 micrometer thickness gem. We have three gems, which are done like this. This detector has a total volume of 50 liter, and it's read out by a CMOS camera, which is an Orca Fusion, and four PMTs. The detector at the moment is operating underground at Laboratori Nazionali del Gran Sasso. These are some tracks as they appear in LIME. These are some underground electron recoil. This is an overground picture at very high exposure of natural radioactivity. And here you can see that we are able to separate two cosmic tracks of 500 micrometers spaced. These are some performances that we have reached with LIME using an iron 55 source, which emits X-rays at 5.9 keV. This is the iron peak that we can clearly see, which shows around a 10% energy resolution. This is the light integral variation that we have characterized. There is this variation in light response due to the saturation of the gem, and we are working to correct for this effect. Indeed, an iron spot, this is a 5.9 keV electron, which is produced at 5 centimeter distance from the gem, will not diffuse, so the charge density will be very high, and this will saturate at amplification plane, while if the iron spot is produced farther, it diffuse a lot, so there is a lower charge density, and so at the end they will not saturate. With our new camera, we are and the high gains, we are able to reach a threshold of 300 around 300 electron volt, and we have demonstrated some absolute Z fiducialization with a resolution at the moment below 10 centimeter along the wall drift volume. At the moment, LIME is underground. We performed the run one without any shielding before the commissioning of the detector. Then we moved to run two with 5 centimeter copper shielding. Finally, run three with 10 centimeter copper shielding. And it's in progress now, the run number four with 10 centimeter copper shielding. Plus 40 centimeter water shielding. This is still in progress. This is to study the materials of the detector and to validate the Monte Carlo. Indeed, as you can see, for run one, we obtain a nice data Monte Carlo. We obtain a nice data Monte Carlo comparison. While for run two and run three, we think that there is some additional contamination in the gas that we are not yet able to model. But we are going towards this direction because probably we found what is it.
But you were aware that your PMTs are hell radioactive.
That our PMT are
radioactive like hell.
Yes, but they are placed very far from the gem plane, so the contribution of the PMT should be very low.
But still, the thing that goes far, you say that there is very little solid angle.
Yes.
You take a light guide. That's
No, we just have the PMT facing we have just the PMT facing the last gem plane.
right. Okay.
Hang on. Okay, so for the future, we plan to build the 0. cubic meter detector with 50 times 80 centimeter square triple gem system. It will be a back-to-back TPC with common cathode and will be read out by four CMOS sensors and 12 PMTs. This prototype will be used to study the materials and demonstrate the scalability of the detection technique towards the order 30 cubic meter prototype. Indeed, in the phase two, foreseen this Cigno 30 cubic meter detector, and thanks to the modularity of our detection technique, it will be composed by many Cigno 04 modules. And with a 30 cubic meter detector, we could give a significant contribution in dark matter searches for spin-independent and spin-dependent coupling. And this could additionally give the first directional measurement of neutrino from the PP cycle, depending on the background, as we will see later. So dark matter detector like this can be also employed to study solar neutrinos with the feature of the directionality. So neutrinos are produced in the sun by the two main sources, which are the PP chain and the CNO cycles. All these neutrinos have been observed by Kamio Kande. Most of these neutrinos have been observed by Kamio Kande and Borexino. Although Borexino had a very high threshold, which is around 160 keV on the electron energy, while we plan to have a threshold of 10 keV on the electron energy. And additionally, the CNO cycle has not been studied precisely enough to solve the solar metallicity problem. The idea of performing this measurement, also of solar neutrino through neutrino electron elastic scattering, has been proposed in the 90s, and the directional detection offers several advantages. For example, we have the capability of discriminating signal from background, from the source direction. We can perform, since the kinematic is closed once we measure the angle between the electron and the neutrino, the kinematic is closed, so there is a possibility of an event-by-event neutrino energy reconstruction. And additionally, the directional signature of a peak distribution over a flat background is a much stronger signature than searching for an exponential falling exponential signal over a falling exponential background as an energy distribution. In the Cigno gas mixture, we expect around one event per year per cubic meter. So in a 30 cubic meter experiments, we expect around 30 events per year. Why to perform this measurement? Okay, Borexino have measured the PP flux with a 300 keV threshold, so essentially measured only the very last part. Moreover, Borexino measured, as I said, measured the CNO, but not with enough precision to address the solar metallicity problem. Additionally, the background for the CNO are the 7 beryllium line and the PP line, which could be resolved with spectroscopy. So, study the feasibility of this measurement is useful for exploring the power of the directionality in the context of a measurement. Study the feasibility for the future Cigno 30 experiment that, with very low threshold and directionality, would be sensitive to new physics, for which there is an increasement of cross-section. There could be an increasement in cross-section due to new physics, or the change on the angular distribution due, for example, to new light mediators. Additionally, this measurement could serve as to demonstrate the feasibility of a future measurement of the CNO cycle with a larger detector, and around 1,000 cubic meters are needed. This work is in the context of the Cygnus proto collaboration, which aim at building a global network of TCP to form a galactic Le Coilos observatory with directional sensitivity to dark matter and neutrinos. And thanks to the modularity and the multi-site distribution of the detector, scaling to 100-1,000 cubic meters appear feasible. And these are the different physics cases to which we are sensitive with n modules of 10 cubic meter. We can arrive up to galactic supernova pointing, breaking through the neutrino floor, giant neutrino, and dark matter astronomy. So the first step is to characterize the detector response for low energy electron recoil. And for this, I did a study of linearity and energy resolution over ground with different X-ray source at 5.9 keV using the Eros source, at different energies using alphas, impinging of different material, and using the gamma produced by the K-alpha and K-beta shell. Lower energies with iron impinging on calcium at 3.7 keV. And here you can see how the tracks appear. This is the tracks in our detector, and below 10 keV, they look like a spot-like track, while at eigenenergy, they start to show an extension. I did a simple selected we did a simple selection on the data, and the fit on the tracks have been done with two exponential to models the camera noise, and the second exponential to model the background, plus a Gaussian to model the peak. And from here we obtained a kind of linear response up to 35 kV, and an energy resolution which is around constant at 13% at 8 kb. We excluded the iron point from the fit because all the parameters of the reconstruction code have been tuned to minimize the energy resolution on the iron spot. Okay, the second step is the development of a simulation to produce low energy electron recoil CMOS images. So we developed the simulation to go from a GENT for track model, insert all the detector response effect, and finally we produce a CMOS-like image of a low energy electron recoil. During the in the simulation, we simulate the primary electron production, the diffusion in the gas, the amplification in the gems, the diffusion in the gems, the amplification with the saturation effect, the light production, optical effect, sensor response, and finally pedestal addition to produce the CMOS images. So here, for example, we calculate the average once for every point of the track. We calculate the average number of primary electron produced, and we consider them to fluctuate Poissonially. Then we diffuse the electrons, and once they are at the gem, we extract for every electron, we extract a gem gain from an exponential distribution, and we amplify the electron by the gem gains by the gem gain. We repeat this process for the first gem and for every primary electron up to arriving at the third gem. And the third gem is the one where we think that the saturation effect is dominant. So what we do is that we diffuse all the electrons of the track in a three-dimensional cloud made by three-dimensional voxels, and the number of electrons in every voxel is multiplied by this quantity, which take into account the saturation effect given the density of electrons in each voxel. Finally, given the total number of electron, we project this cloud on the XY plane, and for all the photons in the pixel, we convert the number of electrons in the number of photons from this conversion factor. Then we apply the Poissonian fluctuation to this number of photons. We apply the optical correction effect through the solid angle. And finally, we convert the number of photon in camera DC counts, and we add the sensor noise to the simulation as an image from a real pedestal.
Hold it. So here you have again when you go through the when you go through the
Third gem,
gem,
yes.
you're gonna get again on the production of electrons, right?
Yes.
So this is G. And
Yes.
this fluctuates with K fluctuations. Where is this thing in your it comes out.
Here, for every ionization electron, for the first gem, we extract for every primary electron, we extract again from an exponential distribution, and then we amplify the electrons.
What is the signal? What about your fluctuation? The fluctuation of that signal.
We take into account the fluctuation in gain from the exponential distribution. We do it for the first gem and the second
Okay,
gem.
you can measure that.
Yes. Then we do the same for the third gem, but considering the saturation. Then we consider Poissonian fluctuation in photon productions
Okay.
because they have this average, but they are expected
Why
to.
Poisson? You have a fun factor here of something.
We have not. We think that The Fano factor is irrelevant, and we have considered only the Poissonian fluctuation in photon
You
production.
think it's Poissonian for some good reason, or?
There should be Poissonian, given
I don't know. I mean, I
the
don't know
rules.
in your case. In xenon, Fano is sub Poissonian, so you're better off than
But
Poisson.
maybe given the low density of the gas, it's not.
In the gems, it should be worse than Poissonian. This is my question. So, if it's worse than Poissonian, then
They are being
it made a little bit of an effect. a bit optimistic.
That's the question. This is
I
what I'm trying to figure out,
mean,
because
the
at the
number
end
of
of the
photons
day.
produced there is the photons that you produce in the gem, right? In the triple gem or in the last.
No, after the third gem, the electron breaks the CF4 molecules, which will end up in an excited state. And when the CF4 molecule excites, they produce
So it's
gammas.
electroluminescence. It's
Huh?
electroluminescence, the
Or
third part.
scintillation. Yeah, it's kind of
Why, no?
electroluminescence.
So do you have the electric field of the last gem?
No, we don't have.
But basically, it's the electrons that go from the hole and goes to the back side of the gem. Yes.
Yes. To
So
the
it's
last
more
set
or
of the
less
gem.
EL,
In
kind
more or
of
less the end is
EL.
more or
No,
less.
sir, then.
Just,
But
it's very interesting the way you do it. So we're trying to understand the let's
whole
say
thing.
we produce light mainly here, inside the
Yeah.
literally inside
But
of
this is
the
what
hole.
Frances is saying. It's not obvious to me, at least, that the light production in that gem, in that narrow gap, it has a Fano factor which is negligible. It Fano factor there could be
No,
easily.
if the light, the most of the light is produced in the hole, the Fano factor is worse than
Exactly,
one.
exactly. If it is Because out of the you
hole.
have two effects. You have the exponential effect that and you have the exponential effect of ionization, ionizing the gas, and then you're losing energy also by exciting the molecules and so on. Exactly.
So you have two ways of losing energy. Okay,
And then
yes.
you're splitting the energy in random ways that it's going to affect your fluctuations. So
Okay, so
you should try to measure that.
let's say we suppose our fluctuation to be Poissonian, and then we use this value which have been measured, which has been measured by a colleague of us.
When you measure that, do you fit? I mean, do you have a measurement of the resolution or the fluctuations of this production?
I didn't put the plot here, but there is a trend as a function of the number of electrons, and
So you should be able to extract the Fano factor there.
yeah, I will have a look at it. We'll think about it. Okay, so to go on, we carried on an extensive parameters optimization for the parameters of the simulation that we don't know, like the absorption length, the saturation. I didn't say, but we also saturated the absorption of we also simulated the absorption of primary electrons, the saturated gain coefficients, and the size of the voxel. So after an extensive work of parameter optimization, we have been to reach a nice agreement between data and Monte Carlo. This is the response of the detector for the light response for the simulation, and this is the performances of energy resolution as a function of the energy.
Two things. First of all, why so non-linear at 45? You just boom, stop being linear at 45 kV.
Okay, because here.
You're linear more or less until 25.
Yeah, the point is that we are not linear here, because here we are dominated by saturation. Because since, as I showed you before, here the tracks appear as a spot, and if you increase the energy, essentially you increase the charge density in the spot. Going here, you saturate more, increasing the energy. When you arrive here, what happens is that the track will start to show a tail with a lower charge density, which will not saturate, while only the head of the track will saturate. So the more you increase in energy, the more you will, it's a bit counterintuitive, but the more you increase in energy, the more you will start to have non-saturated part of the track.
At the end of the drug.
Yes, it saturates only the head of the track, while the tail doesn't saturate. We did a check, we did a study on Mi particle, and effectively Mi particle do not saturate.
Okay, so when I look at the plot back, what you say is that at, no, here, at say 45 kV, these tracks are already long enough, and I am not losing. So see that you have like three trends.
Yes,
It's a
one
plot,
here
yeah,
and
and
one here.
changes, and it's not obvious to me that don't change again, but yeah, maybe it's two trends, right?
Yeah, I see two trends,
And you
like
say it's
one
two trends
here and
here,
one here.
and it comes because once the track starts to be long,
No,
I'm
exactly.
not saturated and I come here. This is neat. Now look at the plot on the right. The right,
Okay.
your data seems to be consistently worse resolution than your Monte Carlo, right?
Yes,
Now,
seems kind of.
Fano in other business could be still a real factor, right? The fact that you are not fully simulating these effects.
Yes,
It could
it could be an
contribute
effect, it could be a
to
contribution. But the point is that it's not just a simulation to get to study the linearity of the response and the energy resolution, but
Indeed,
it's to
very nice.
produce the whole track. For example, these are two 30 kV electrons. One is simulated and one is a real track. Then indeed we proceeded by comparing also a set of nine topological track shape variables between data and Monte Carlo to see if there is an agreement between the tracks that we are producing and we are simulating. And we did this, I did this with the SPLOT tool.
Sorry. In the plots, yeah, in those plots, have you tried to do the same plots for different sets? Because at long set, you should not saturate, so you should not see those effects.
At long?
A long set?
Long, like high energy?
No.
No, a long grid distance at all.
Near the cathode. Yeah, if you select events near the cathode, you should not saturate.
No, because we took the data just in the center of the detector between like 15 and 30 centimeter. We placed the source from the top, so we cannot do the absolute Z position of the track from the data at least.
You don't have primary scintillation here that you can play with?
No, we don't have primary scintillation because our
No.
gas mixture
But
is.
your gas is quenched, of course.
Yes, exactly. So we our the primary
You don't know when your
scintillation.
track where your track is in your TPC.
At the moment for iron, yes, we do with
Yeah, maybe fusion.
as I showed you before, we are a bit sensitive to the position, but not with absolute precision. We are doing now a lot of studies on the PMT, and we should be able later.
Oh.
Because for these tracks, it's a bit more complicated to get the diffusion. Because for a spot, you analyze
Oh,
only the
diffusion,
spot.
by
Yeah.
diffusion.
Okay,
Yeah, diffusion, fine.
so what we did was to compare the track topological variable and to extract the topological quantities for the pure signal, we used the SPLOT tool. Essentially, with this tool, if you fit a variable with a known model containing one background and another species, which could be signal one and signal two, when you perform an unbounded likelihood fit, you are able to assign to each event a weight which is proportional of the probab to the probability of that event. Belonging to that species. For example, if I fit this data with a background and two signals, if I build the histogram of the charge density distribution weighting the H event by the quantity PB assigned from the SPLOT, I'm able to obtain the density distribution for only background events. And if I do it for the quantity PS2, which is for the second signal, I'm able to obtain the charge density distribution for the pure S2. For example, this is what I obtained for the background, and the blue crosses here is a run without sources. So it means that here I've been able to extract the background component since it's comparable with a no source run. This is the data Monte Carlo comparison for different quantities. The yellow plot is the simulation, while the blue crosses are the data. And this quantity are length, width of the track, the ratio length over width, track density, energy over length of the track, Gaussian profile, number of pixels, and so on. Some fine tuning is still needed, but given the complexity of the simulation, we can say that we have reached a reasonable result. Okay, the next step is to study the bidimensional angular resolution on low energy electron recoil. So since we don't have, okay, this is one of the key points for this measurement. The biggest problem is that electrons undergo multiple scattering in gas, and the directionality is lost after few millimeters. So for example, this is the 2D projection of an electron recoil produced in this direction, and you can see that soon after 3 millimeters, the original direction is completely lost.
And this is at your pressure, and your pressure is what?
This is atmospheric pressure.
One atmosphere.
Yeah. One atmosphere. And this is a
millimeters.
50 kV, these are 50 kV electron recoils. So it's not enough to fit the beginning and the end of the track, and a dedicated algorithm to perform this operation is needed. Since it's not easy to have a directional monochromatic electron recoil source, the algorithm has been tested on the track produced with the simulation, which agrees with the data. And the study is done from 2D track, and the third core, the PMT information, will be added in the future. So the algorithm has been adapted from X-ray polarimetry, from the X-ray polarimetry, which have similar track to this, but at much lower energy. Indeed, X-ray polarimetry work in a range from 2 to 8 keV, while here we have to handle a much higher variety of topology of tracks. Okay, the first part aim at searching for the beginning of the track, exploiting the skewness, so the third momentum of this distribution, which gives an idea of the asymmetry of the distribution, which tells where the end of the track is and where the beginning of the track is. So what we do is to search for a point far from the bicenter on the opposite side of the peak. We do this search until we enlarge this radius, until we have selected a fixed number of points. From there, since the directional information is contained at the very beginning of the track, every pixel is rescaled exponentially from the distance of the interaction point by this quantity. After the scaling, the direction is taken by fitting the light profile with a line passing by the interaction point. There are two parameters of the algorithm which are not known, and to optimize the parameter of the algorithm, I produced a dataset of different energy, and for the different energies, I have studied the angular resolution as a function of the two parameters. We can see that there is a minimum here where the angular resolution is considered as the sigma of the distribution of theta measured minus theta true. There is this line, which of course is when the algorithm fails, since we cannot reconstruct the direction of tracks which are produced towards the gem plane, since we see the projection.
You are not using the set component.
Sorry?
No.
You are not using the set component.
No.
Which component?
The third component. You're using
the axial.
No, we are not using the third component at the moment because we are missing the PMT analysis, but we are working on it.
Okay.
So this is just bidimensional. Two-dimensional, exactly. Okay, so these are the optimal parameters that we have found for every energy. And this is the angular resolution performance evaluated on a dataset we track produced uniform in energy within 16 and 70 kV. Okay, here there is some border effect which are produced from the parameter. As you can see here, the parameters are constant, then there is a change in a different range, and then they change again. Probably this is an effect of this, the set of the parameter chosen.
So the fit here is
the polynomial.
Degrees.
So the polynomial.
It's P0 plus P1 over square root of E. It's a functional form. Then the point is that P0 here is negative, but we believe that if we start to test it on tracks at higher energy, we will be more more sensey. We will have a P0 saturating to a flat variables.
Okay, because it's a bit unphysical that you have.
No, yes, of course, but because we miss tracks at very high energy, because we cannot even contain, don't contain in the detector tracks at higher energy.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have seen that the angular resolution as a function of the energy has been evaluated for different drift distances. And here we see essentially no difference in angular resolution as a function for different drift distances. While one thing that affects a lot the angular resolution is the angle with respect to the gem plane. So producing this track parallel to the gem plane, we see that we have a good resolution, while this gets much worse when we produce tracks towards the gem plane. Okay, the last thing are the sensitivity studies for the solar PP neutrino with the Cigno 30 cubic meter experiment and kind of in time.
Okay,
the resolutions have been evaluated, the angular and energy resolutions have been evaluated on LIME. When we will build the biggest detector, will feature a similar granularity and the same drift distance. So we in principle, we can expect at least the same performances, if not better. And since we foreseen a 30 cubic meter detector to be composed by many Cigno 0-4 modules, for this analysis, we have assumed the energy resolution and the angular resolution for LIME. Then another assumption is that we assume the same resolution in both theta and phi, since let's say given the sampling rate of the BMT and the drift velocity, in principle in Z we should expect the same granularity that we have in X and Y. So we have done this assumption. We assume an isotropic gamma background, especially in solar coordinate. We assume the energy and the angular resolution taken from the energy resolution from the data and the Monte Carlo and the angular resolution measured by the Monte Carlo. And we assume a threshold on the electron energy of 10 keV, which corresponds to a 55 keV threshold on the neutrino energy. Okay, the sensitivity has been performed using the sensitivity studies have been performed using the Bayesian framework. The strategy is to model the signal and the background, produce the template. So the response, let's say the theoretical distribution with the response of the detector, produce a set of time Monte Carlo, and study the perform a likelihood fit of signal with a signal plus background model and an only background model, calculate the bias factor and the discovery probability as a function of the exposure. To have an idea of the background, I did a simulation of a 30 cubic meter detector, supposing it to be composed by three rows of 25 Cigno 0-4 modules. From the LIME simulation, we have seen which are the most critical elements that produce radioactivity in our detector, which are the resistors, the lens of the camera and the sensor, the field cage, the cathode, the gem, and the detector body. To realize the simulation, I supposed to build the detector with the most ultra-pure material which are available in the market. For example, the electroformed copper used by the Majorana collaboration.
It's a bit extreme, right? Because your detector is going to be very big.
The detector is going to be very big.
You're not going to use electroformed copper for all that.
Yeah, probably
would
no.
What is the background level of the electroform copper? Do you remember it?
It's written here, the marmor is here. It's very, very pure.
So this is something you guys need to seriously consider. Because this is a big detector.
It's very big, yes.
And you're not gonna produce all this electroform copper. At least it's not gonna be at all easy because it's a lot of copper.
Yes, sir.
And if you go to commercial copper, or even very good copper,
commercial copper
will give you, normal copper that you find, which is good already, is 10 microbecquerel per kilogram, and excellent copper, really good copper, is 1 or 2 microbecquerel. So you're assuming a factor 10 less.
Yes.
And this is too much.
It will be, yes, that, I think that, it will be pretty hard.
That is very optimistic in a large detector. So it would be interesting to see how well you do if you just assume something a bit more conservative, like 1 microbecquerel per kilogram, because for the gem, I can believe that the copper, you can do.
You have to do 5 micrometers.
For the body of the TPC, I don't believe it at all.
Yeah, but for example, the copper that we have is, for example, okay, maybe not the cathode, which should be 5 millimeter thick. Mm-hmm. We can do the cathode. For the rest, the copper that we use is a micrometers of copper to build the gem. Micrometer of copper so to build the strip of the field cage. The vessel, okay, probably the vessel cannot be done with.
It is interesting to if you assume that in a number of places the strip, the cathode, you assume like an order of magnitude more, mm-hmm. Does that thing ruin your? Are you still okay, or is it going to kill your machine?
I will show you. So, I supposed to use this electroformed copper, the acrylic from SNO, the SMD resistors from Xenon 1 ton, and the lens is made by this Subrasil. And for this, I considered the data that we have performed at LNGS. The materials employed at the moment for lime are ordered 10 to the 2, 10 to the 4 times more radioactive. This is why I didn't consider that. Okay, I've done for every contaminant and for every detector element, I simulated the decay of all the isotopes with considering the whole radioactive chain, if it's not where it's not specified that the secular equilibrium is broken. I have normalized the use with the activity and the mass, and this is the spectrum that I obtain, where indeed the most critical component is the field cage, because it requires a lot of acrylic. And the acrylic, despite being the one of SNO, which is very radio-poor, it's still very radioactive. So I would expect that if I consider the vessel made by normal copter, the number of events in the region greater than 10 keV, which is 1.7 10 to the 4 events per year, I would expect it to increase of a factor 3, 4, not more.
Factor 3. Why is a factor 3 when it comes to factor 3?
I would expect it from previous measurement where I haven't found already the electroformed copper, so I was considering the opera copper, for example.
That is a good number.
That is a good number, according to me, yes. Maybe I should consider the opera copter. This is very optimistic.
Just because it's more credible. If you still get a good result without saying that your copper has no radioactivity, mm-hmm. People are going to believe you more.
Yes, probably, yes. OK. Kevin?
Yes.
Okay, so I produced the template where for every energy, this is the expected electron spectrum smeared with the energy resolution. And for every bin of energy, I have considered also the angular distribution of the electron recoil. I did the same for the background, where the background has been considered flat in angle. Okay, I've produced for different exposure and for different farther reduction of the farther reduction of the background. I have extracted Poissonially then the number of signal expected and the number of background expected, and I've calculated the bias factor for every toy. And for the toy distribution, I've calculated the discovery, I've estimated the discovery probability as the number of toy, which give a bias factor greater than 5 divided by the total number of toys. Okay, these are the results of the sensitivity study. So this point means that if I manage to further reduce the background of a factor 10, I have 50% probability of make this measurement in 6 years. Of course, this improves a lot with reducing the background. But one key point is that we have seen that with 180 we can observe 180 neutrino over 10,000 events of background with the discriminating power of the directionality. Well, for example, for the CNO, Borexino had a factor 2 of no, for the with the PP, Borexino had a factor 2 of signal over background, while we can tolerate a factor 100 of signal over background. Okay, then possible optimizations for this measurement. Let's say here I have used the current setup. I have not optimized anything. I said, okay, this is the detector. I do everything with this. But there is a space of optimization because, for example, with a gas mixture of helium CF4, 8020, 60 keV trucks start to show directionality. There is the choice of the gem configuration. For example, a double gem configuration shows a slightly worse energy resolution, but a much improved diffusion, which means an improved tracking. Choice of the gem voltage and use, for example, the electroluminescence. We managed to operate in electroluminescence condition, adding a very strong electric field at the end of the third gem. And this could solve the problem of the saturation, improve the energy resolution, and improve the energy resolution. Maybe we could get a cleaner signature with an higher energy threshold. Finally, last slide, and then I'm done. In the context of the Initium project, we managed to operate our small prototype at really at nearly atmospheric pressure, 900, 0.9 atmosphere, because we are in the Gran Sasso and the pressure is lower. And we reached the negative ion as charge carrier. We managed to operate, use negative ions as charge carrier with the addition of a small amount of SF6, 1.6%. It's not clear from the image, but these trucks have the same light integral, but the dynamical range is totally different. But as you can see, the diffusion that we reach is much, much, much smaller. Which means a better improved a lower diffusion means an improvement in tracking, which is an improvement in directionality performances. And here you can see the diffusion for the different drift field as a function of the distance. And you can see, okay, you cannot see the fields, but you can see that the vertical scale is the same. You can see that the diffusions drop a lot. And currently, this is the last point is one is compatible with the lowest diffusion ever measured in a gas TPC. Okay, these are my, so maybe repeating the measurement with negative ion diffusions, performing the measurement of solar neutrino with improved directionality and negative ion diffusions could be the key to perform this measurement. Okay, so these are my conclusion. The solar neutrino measurement well with a TPC as with a TPC has been proposed, in which the directionality can increase the background toleration and lead to a spectroscopic measurement of solar neutrino. I've studied the energy and directionality performances of a 50 liters prototype. And okay, as a Cigno 30 cubic meter experiment, if we managed to constrain the background down to a certain certain threshold, a certain value, this measurement can be done in a reasonable amount of time. And this is the same condition that we have to obtain to perform a meaningful dark matter searches. And thank you.
Why don't you go directly to negative ion? Looks much better.
Mm.
Except for the fact that you're going to all die poisoned by extrachloride of selenium, you're all going to die.
SF6 is not toxic.
SF6, it was not the same one from...
Yeah, there's no selenium.
It's not
this one is not, it's not selenium.
It's CS2, it's which...
is the one that used for high voltage insulation.
Okay. So why don't you do ions directly? I mean, look...
Okay, better. Because at the moment...
Because reading ions is not easy.
Exactly.
He does it.
We did it, but yeah, the detector is not super stable, and we at the moment we are able to see alphas with negative ions.
So sorry, can you explain how you read the alphas or the ions?
Here we have americium source which produce alphas inside the detector.
How do you amplify the signal of this?
With the gems, three gems.
So you extract the electron from the SF6.
Yes, so we strip the electron from the SF6 and this electron undergo avalanche.
So you have to operate the gems at what voltage in comparison with...
Okay, for electro, for three, we operate it at 400 volt. Okay, to see the only alphas, we can compare 320 volts and 520 volts.
Twice, more or less. So a little less than twice, 1.7.
200 volts more to obtain the same gain. But our device is not specifically developed for negative ion mixers. It can be optimized, and in some in that case, we should be able to see electron recoil. But at the moment, we don't see electron recoil we don't see electron recoil. But we have a very good detector for alpha also because we see only alpha. If we go on like this, maybe we can be sensitive to nuclear recoil and to nothing else. And we have a detector like Pico, for example, which is sensitive only to nuclear recoil and nothing else. Who knows? But these are also very, very, very recent.
So this is a small prototype that you have? Or?
This is a small prototype that we have. See, yes, this is a 10 by 10 centimeter square gems with a variable drift field up to 15 centimeters.
And this is all part of the Elisabetta project? Or?
This is all part of the Elisabetta project, yes, it's part of Initium.
Okay. So this is all great. I mean, it's a very interesting thing. The only thing that worries me is that, the result of your study says, you know, it's a very hard thing. I need to reduce the background.
Yes.
And my impression is that you already are at the limit of
background reduction
because of the copper again, and because you are really assuming very ultra pure everywhere. It's not, except for the copper, it's not unrealistic, but I don't think you're going to get any better than that in your basic materials. So how are you going to further reduce the background?
Okay, but for example, now we are supposing to use modules like these. Mm-hmm. But for example, we could do it a bit bigger. You could change the
geometry.
Then you
will have it with the scalability. So
about that and about gas mixtures, I guess that the idea of using Ilium CS4 is to have longer tracks, right?
The idea of adding Ilium to CF4, yes, is to reduce the gas density, reduce the multiple scattering, and have longer tracks for a better tracking.
So have you considered to increase the pressure but add a magnetic field? Because that will, in principle, maintain the diffusion.
If you increase the pressure, you lose sensitivity very soon to the directionality.
Sure, but you have a lot of mass.
We look at the magnetic field in the past.
No, but it's pure xenon.
But at 10 bar is hopeless, but one more.
No, no, but pure xenon is different than mixtures.
The what?
Pure xenon is different than mixtures. In mixtures, you can, in principle, find the right mixture where you maintain or you have a good diffusion, and then you can increase mass.
It was a multiple scattering, if I remember correctly, that made our life very miserable.
Well, we're looking at different things because you were looking to separate one electron to two electrons.
Yes.
But there, I'm just saying that in the original PET4TPC, they had a mixture with a magnetic field, and the diffusion they had was similar to what they have now.
And they increased the mass. So the magnetic,
they were operating at 8 bar.
The magnetic field was a trick to keep.
Yes, of course, the trust will be smaller.
They use the V cross H effect to.
But
the
you lose directionality if you put the magnetic.
I'm saying that maybe there is a sweet spot where even if you lose a little bit of directionality at very low energies, you have much more mass.
But maybe, as you said, you start to totally lose directionality if you put a magnetic field, because even if the electron doesn't scatter, it rotates.
I don't think.
Okay, by the way, we really don't plan to use a magnetic field, also because we have these things of negative ions to reduce the diffusion. So let's say we are pointing.
So you are aiming to push on this direction.
We are aiming to push on this direction, yes. And
are you considering to use this chip to read ions without amplification?
To read?
There is a chip that was. It's not called Kitix, it's
the one from Gambia.
Okay, sometime Kitix.
Yeah.
They got a paper out today, well, yesterday.
But Kitix is the one that they want to use for Dune, right? No, it's not the one for Dune.
It's some pixelated readout.
Yeah.
Which interface directly with
the glass.
Okay, let's say no, because that device should be a bit more difficult to scale with respect to CMOS.
What do you mean, as CMOS?
Can you start if you have to image, like for example, 3 meters times 3 meters?
Well, that's what they
well,
they can
yeah.
do.
That's what they're going to do in Dune. So
no. This is not the.
No, but that's similar.
No.
Even like LARPix in the near detector.
No. It's what they want to do for the Chinese next. I don't know what the Panda 3.
Ah.
There are some colleagues of us which are trying to do that from the Cygnus collaboration. Let's say the idea is to develop the different technique and then eventually to converge in a unique technique. We are pushing currently for this technique of the optical readout at the moment.
Okay, but no, the thing is here you probably have instabilities on the gems. Right.
Sorry, you?
You have instabilities on the gems.
Yes, no, we managed to be pretty stable in reality. Our detector is very stable in this condition at the moment. So we don't have so many instabilities. The point is that if we push more to try to see electron recoil, yes, we start to sparks and do things. But there are, for example, new approaches. Like, for example, people have produced the gem with an additional amplification stage after the hole. After the hole, there is another band that provides further amplification. For example, we have to study this in deep because probably what we observe also, what we think also is that in the gap between the two gems, the electrons amplified recombine immediately, so you have to strip it again. For example, building a system which where the gem are stacked closer, if you prevent the recombination after the first amplification, you can start, you can effectively produce more light and operate with more gain at lower tensions. So this is like the beginning, and this is the first time that someone observed negative ion that perform negative ion operations with optical readout. We have a lot of space to test different devices, also gas mixtures and other things.
Okay, let's thank Samuel. I don't know, maybe we are already.
So you don't treat your track
much more.
You don't do any imaging treating to your tracks? I mean, like the convolution techniques?
Oh, no, nothing. We just
win a lot.
Huh?
You could win a lot on the track definition with the convolution techniques.
Probably yes. We have never thought about this this approach, but these are like really the raw tracks that we see in the picture. We just
that's what I'm wondering. Do you use the raw tracks for your analysis?
Yes, we just draw a contour around the track. We select the track and we use that.
Okay, we are going to have lunch with him, so we can ask him questions offline.
What time?
In 20 minutes.
Okay.
No, but we need to vacate the room. The guy that manages all the.
Okay, let's discuss the line.
Thank you, guys.
Can we change Italians?
Sì, è vero.
Noi abbiamo questo, ci sono moltissime
Sì, mi ha detto che nei cristalli funziona molto bene. Lo so, però la network. No, sì, è vero. Effettivamente è vero. Solo che.
Sì, esatto. Stavo se volevo dirgli io.
Senza resistenza per questi pesci stronzi. Perché la network, io me lo so fare.
In effetti, quella è l'applicazione per immagini bidimensionali.
Esatto, il problema. Ce l'abbiamo anche con dimensionale.
Sì, no, per loro è ancora più facile perché hanno due immagini di
dimensionale.
Non è una
questione tra la tridimensionalità.